Welcome to the Last in Line podcast, where we discuss faith, hope, and truth in the lives of amazing servant leaders. You are in the right place if you crave purpose and if you hunger for a life of significance. This podcast applies biblical truth to our daily lives, and we pray that you walk away encouraged and inspired. This is the Last in Line podcast.
We are now partnering with Christ Coffee, who is an online business that is working to save children from sex trafficking, and they are spreading the gospel throughout the world. Christ Coffee is more than just a brand. It is a movement where each cup is a testament to their commitment to high-quality beans, the spread of the gospel, and making a tangible impact in the community and around the world. Their mission, guys, we can partner with that. And each cup you brew actually does go to saving a child. So they're actually blessing us and our customers, our listeners, with a discount. So type in Last in Line and you'll get 10% off of your first order. And it is quality premium coffee beans. Gentlemen, the dark roast is some of the best I've ever had. So don't wait. Go to Christ Coffee. Order your first bag, use Last in Line for 10% off that first order, and I guarantee you'll keep coming back. Brew a cup, rescue a child with Christ Coffee. Sometimes I wonder why men, Christian men specifically, seem to be a little bit intimidated or apprehensive in prayer. Sometimes I feel like men tiptoe around it, kind of gingerly, with trepidation, approach prayer like they're playing craps and they're gambling with whether or not God's listening, whether or not the promises are real, the rewards are for them, or if God's even listening to them. I want to present something to you today that might empower us all to step with a little more conviction, a little more confidence, a little more boldness, and with more authority in our prayer life. I can grow in this area. I'm focusing on this quite a bit here in the last, 8 to 12 months, seems like, and I want that to be part of my DNA going forward, because I think that separates us from not only lost people who don't know Jesus, but new Christians and Christians who have been lulled to sleep in complacency in a vanilla approach to their Christianity and their spiritual life and leadership. I think that separates us, and I believe it puts us at the tip of the spear where we belong as men who serve Jesus and believe in the death, burial, and resurrection, especially those of us who believe in the power of the Holy Spirit imparting wisdom and power and help to our lives that allow us to stand in the gap for people, that allow us to wield the sword of the Spirit, the Word of God, in spiritual warfare, and that allow us to stand upright and stand firm, representing those we love, lead, and serve. So, gentlemen, I'm bringing you five prayers that every Christian man should know, should learn, should apply, should execute, and should claim as their own in victory. Now, why would you say most men, or let's just say a lot, let's not say most, let's just say a lot of Christian men are a little intimidated? Do they feel unqualified, maybe? They feel like their past has disqualified them and scarred them beyond recognition for the Lord to honor and justify and sanctify their prayer petitions? Do we feel like they might be a little less, maybe they're deficient in knowledge of the Word of God? Maybe they don't feel sufficient in their knowledge base and what they can approach God with to sound worthy and superior spiritually? Maybe they feel like it just flat out doesn't work, that slot machine is broken. Or maybe they've gone to the well one too many times and haven't heard the answer they were looking for. I don't think you would agree that God is our, return on investment, let's say. He's not a stock that we're putting money in hoping to get a 3 or 4-fold yield in our, you know, our investment. I trust God, and I believe His timing's real. And sometimes unanswered prayers are the ones that we really should be thankful for, even more so maybe than the answered prayers, because we don't know what we don't know. When we're asking for things, or we're petitioning and we're submitting our requests to God and our cares, we don't know that what we're asking might be detrimental or counterproductive to the purpose and calling He has on our life. We don't know. We just know that what we want in the here and now is real. And we feel like that on the surface is what in the natural we're thinking makes sense. There's nothing wrong with that. I'm not judging you or me, because I've done it. But I think we're asking the wrong questions. So God doesn't only listen to those Christians with the S on their chest, the superheroes of the faith, the Billy Grahams of the world, right? He doesn't just see those people and acknowledge and honor their requests or their prayers, their supplication, their petition. You and I are the same. He's no respecter of persons. He wants to listen and hear, but He also wants us to, in faith and obedience, trust that He knows more than we do. His ways are higher than our ways. His thoughts are higher than our thoughts. That's in the Bible. Look it up. Google it on up. And some guys just flat out of ignorance or denial dismiss the premise and concept and reality of a spiritual realm and a war that's happening beyond what we can see in the natural. You guys are in tune with it, but I bet you know some guys at church or in your small group or at the bowling alley or softball field that go to church, read the Bible, or let's say they read their devotional, and maybe they know a few Christian dudes, so that qualifies them for whatever quote-unquote Christian that is. But I would argue that they don't necessarily view the enemy as something they need to fight on a daily basis. They don't necessarily view the devil, Satan, as a real adversary who's looking to kill, steal, and destroy them. And those guys are the ones losing in the spiritual realm. Maybe it even trickles into their natural. There's no fruit. Maybe there's some brokenness. Maybe there's some failure. Of course there's going to be. We're imperfect creatures. But maybe they could stand to take their battle and their fight and their intent into another realm. Maybe that would serve them better, but they got to acknowledge it and own it and understand it and read, for crying out loud, the Bible that says there is a spiritual enemy. We don't fight flesh and blood. So that's why I think we're intimidated sometimes, or maybe just dismissive. I mean, I think men should pray as an act of faith that activates and executes and proves that our faith is real, and it takes faith and trust to send words out into the world, but before the throne, to a Father in heaven who you can't see. You don't know if He's going to answer then or later, if at all. Sometimes a non-answer is an answer. So some of us just maybe forget that that's a paramount act of faith. Faith without works is dead. I would argue works, prayer is part of works. And expressing gratitude to the Father, it's a way to do that and to bear ourselves, our souls, our spirits. It gives us power, because when we pray, you know, in Jesus' name, that removes us from the equation as far as having any sort of authority or control. But we have the authority in Jesus' name that the Holy Spirit goes on our behalf and ensures our quote-unquote victory and authority. But you have to own that. You have to know that it's for you. You have to approach the throne of grace boldly, as it says. And like I said, it's the only way we can fight in a realm that we can't see. And it's the sword that we have to use. So I have five prayers every Christian man should learn. It's going to be pretty simple, and it might be fairly straightforward and intuitive to something that you already practice. I would say we could all get better at it. We could all get more disciplined and religious at it. And I'm not saying we have to be religious, but doing something religiously isn't a bad thing, because it means we're disciplined and consistent and unwavering from that particular habit. And I don't think it's bad to say I pray religiously. I'll take that. I'll wear that. So the first prayer that every man should learn is something that is protection and healing for their family. A lot of traditional denominations think healing is past, think miracles have passed. I'm not in that boat. I don't think you are either. I firmly believe I can pray God's protection over my family. I firmly believe I can pray healing and lay hands, and God's given me that authority by the power of the Holy Spirit and the blood of the cross and the Jesus, in Jesus' name, I have that ability. It's a gift of the Spirit. Healing. I believe in it. I've seen it. I've seen people delivered. I've seen people healed. Maybe you haven't because in your heart, you don't believe it's real. You don't think that that's for you. You don't think you carry that particular gift. And that's on you. It's not about the faith of the other person receiving the healing. While that's important, when we stand over somebody and pray healing in Jesus' name and we rebuke that spirit of infirmity and that demonic force of affliction to flee, we command it and we pray it in Jesus' name, that's it. That's our authority, and that's all we have to do. It doesn't have to be a spectacle, a production. It doesn't have to be sensationalized. It can be just that simple. So in Psalm 91, I claim this over my family, right? Because you have made the Lord your dwelling place, the Most High, who is my refuge. No evil shall befall you or plague come near your tent. No plague, right? No illness, no disease shall come near your tent. Yeah, you're going to get the sniffles. Yeah, you might have a 24-hour stomach bug. I'm not talking about that. But we, even if you do, you pray that to leave you. And we have that authority. It says he will command his angels concerning you to guard you in all your ways. I'll take that. Own that. That's a truth. That's a promise. We can't be selective and discriminating on what truths in the Bible we claim and own and activate our faith within. Psalm 34, many are the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord delivers him out of them all. He keeps all his bones. Not one of them is broken. James 5, 15 and 16, and the prayer of faith will save the one who is sick, and the Lord will raise him up. And if he has committed sins, he will be forgiven. Therefore, confess your sins to one another, pray for one another that you may be healed. The prayer of a righteous man, either says, the version will say, avails much or has great power in its working. So the prayer of a righteous man avails much. It doesn't say we're super holy and perfect, but righteousness is a heart issue. It's a mindset. Those people, prayer of a righteous man avails much, has great power. So that's yours to walk in if you choose to. That's the first one. Number two, we should be learning to pray restoration and redemption for our marriage. Now you might say, I don't really have anything broken in my marriage. We've never had a betrayal. We've never had a colossal failure. We've never had a severe wedge driven between me and my wife. We see eye to eye on everything. We're amicable. We agree on everything. We're super intimate. We're always giving each other what we need when we need it. First of all, I would say you're sorely mistaken, and I think you're lying to yourself because I'm not buying it. But let's say you do have a marriage that hasn't been affected at all or in any significant traumatic fashion. You still need to pray that over your marriage because the enemy isn't done trying to wreck your family. He will try anything. And the fact that you say you haven't had any issue gives him all the more incentive to up his game. So pray that in the future. Pray if for some reason something happens, you can pray that ahead of time. I pray for restoration and redemption. We've had some issues. We've overcome some things by the power of the Holy Spirit and godly people. But I'm continuously praying restoration, reconciliation, healing, favor, redemption in my marriage because I'm flawed. She's flawed. We have an enemy. There's a lot of, you know, that stacks against us if we go passively through this process and we don't claim it in authority over our marriage. We don't take the intention of doing so. Psalm 34, 17 and 18 says, when the righteous cry for help, the Lord hears and delivers them out of all their troubles. The Lord is near to the brokenhearted and saves the crushed in spirit. That's number two, guys. Restoration and redemption for your marriage. Number three, pray for, and I know you probably do, but learn how to take this up a notch. Learn how to stand in conviction and authority. Provision and favor over your resources. Pray these things over your resources. Provision and favor. That doesn't mean you just say, hey, God, I really need this promotion. Or, hey, God, I really need a bonus. Hey, God, we're needing to pay the light bill. Hey, and those are fine. But to stand in by the power of the cross, by Jesus' name, to stand and say, Lord, I claim your promises that I will have life and have it abundantly. That you reward those who diligently seek you. That you will surround us with favor as that of a shield. That you will supply every need that I have according to your riches and glory in Christ Jesus. Those are all scriptures, guys. Hebrews 11:6, I read you part of it. I'll read you the first part. And without faith, it's impossible to please him. For whoever would draw near to God must believe that he exists. That's all of you. And that he's a rewarder of those who seek him. I don't know that you fully believe that he's a rewarder of those who seek him. You can claim you're seeking him. It doesn't help. It doesn't mean you're seeking him if you just check a box in the morning for 5 minutes and then go about your day as a, you know, in the world, doing as the world does. It says, seek first the kingdom and all his righteousness and all these things will be added to you, right? So what's it saying to seek? There's some things that happen after we do that, but we have a part in that. So that's number three, provision and favor over your resources. You've got to make a concerted effort to continue that, even if all's going well. And I live in a life now where my wife's got a good job. I got a good job. We have been blessed. We've seen provision and favor. We've seen abundance and prosperity in our jobs. We've had immense success financially in our jobs. I don't stop praying that just because we feel like we're riding a wave. In fact, I'm probably the opposite to a fault. And I'm like, oh no, you know, this is going really good. I mean, when's the shoe going to drop? And that's not any way to live. That's not living of the Holy Spirit. That's not living with confidence and faith that trusting God in my every minute of every day. So that's number three, guys. Provision and favor over your resources. Number four, dominion and authority over a spiritual enemy. You have dominion over darkness. You have authority over the enemy, and his fiery darts have no place in you or your family. You can pray a covering and a protection. You can pray authority and dominion. If it sounds like I'm redundantly saying and repetitiously saying authority, it's because I want you to know that that's part of our identity in Christ. It's not how great we are, but we have authority in him. It says it all over the place. We're more than conquerors. I mean, we are the royal priesthood, a holy nation. To me, that says we've got some authority in this. It's all in his strength, but we don't fight, like I said, over in flesh and blood always. We're fighting more often in a realm we can't see of a supernatural capacity. 2 Corinthians 10, 3 and 5 says, right, we don't wage war according to the flesh. Our weapons are of our warfare are not flesh. We have divine power, though, to destroy strongholds. So we do that by lifting up every lofty opinion raised against the knowledge of God and taking every thought captive to obey Christ. Ephesians 6 talks about putting on the whole armor of God, right? Because we don't what? We don't wrestle with flesh and blood, but against rulers, authorities, cosmic powers of darkness over spiritual forces of evil. Guys, take up the whole armor of God that you may be able to withstand the evil day, having done all to stand firm. That's pretty clear. That's pretty clear that your fight is really not with your neighbor. Your fight is really not with the idiot in traffic going 45 in the left lane. Your fight is not with the bank calling in its loan. Your fight is not with your boss. Your fight's not even with your spouse. There is an enemy coming at you, and he's using these tools to do it. And he wants to bog you down in the minutiae of the flesh. He wants you to think that if you can just fight every battle here on earth, that you'll ignore the other one in the spiritual realm. And that's where he gets you. That's where he comes to destroy you. And let's face it, he's trying to do that. He's trying to absolutely kill, steal, and destroy. So don't let him acknowledge that realm and get in the fight. Step in with both feet. Stand firm. Claim it with conviction and authority. Pray over your family. Pray dominion and authority over the spiritual realm. That's number four. Number five, guys, five prayers every Christian man should learn. This one is key. This right here is the four-wall framework of pretty much everything you stand for and everything that you can walk in. Because these four things in this one, encapsulated in this one bullet, number five, save the best for last, pray for wisdom, peace, gratitude, and humility. If you can, I hate to say master, but if you can submit these to God and be obedient in Christ and stay faithful in these, he will give you, because it says in James, if you ask for wisdom, he'll give you wisdom, no different than any of the other four, three. I mean, it says, do not be anxious for anything, but everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God, and the peace of God that surpasses all understanding. So it's peace that you can't even understand. It'll guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Don't be anxious. So he promises peace. He promises wisdom. He opposes the proud, gives grace to the humble. So clearly he wants you to ask for that and have that and operate in that. And gratitude. Everything's about gratitude. Therefore, let us be grateful for receiving a kingdom that cannot be shaken. Hebrews 12. And thus let us offer to God acceptable worship with reverence and awe. Reverence and awe. What's more grateful than that when you come to the Lord and to the throne of grace boldly in awe and reverence? That right there, A, shows humility, but it's also saying, I'm grateful that you are who you say you are. And you can't be shaken, so neither can I, because I'm in Christ. Guys, we're too apprehensive. We're too half in, half out of our prayer life. We're too a little bit passive, maybe a little too nice, maybe. I hate to say nice because we're coming to the Lord, but in our spiritual realm that we're fighting against an enemy, we're a little too nice. We're supposed to be warriors in that realm. God called us. He gave us armor, a suit of armor to put on. It's no joke. It's not a cellophane wrapper that we're putting on. It's not a dry cleaner's bag that we're going to battle in, guys. It's not a wet paper sack. It's armor for a reason. So I encourage you guys, five prayers that every man must learn. Here they are. Pray for protection and healing for your family. Pray for restoration and redemption for your marriage. Pray for provision and favor for your over your resources. Pray for dominion and authority over a spiritual realm. And pray for wisdom, peace, gratitude, and humility over everything, in all things, in all moments. If you can carry that, fruits of the Spirit are part of that. Peace, love, joy, kindness, gentleness, goodness, faithfulness, self-control, and patience. If you can incorporate these, God will give them. Ask. You can't do it on your own, or you would already be doing it. Ask. Ask him to reveal things. And I think last week I talked about restore a clean heart in me, O God. I think the prayer is that that David was asking. But a right spirit within me. Lord, guide me in these truths. Guide me in the fruits of the Spirit. Help me be better here. He will. No different than your kids coming to you. He wants you to come to him, and he's willing to honor that. In as you're humble and obedient and surrendered and sold out to him, he's going to grant those things because he wants you to win. He wants you to be better. He wants us to succeed and walk this out because he needs us here to be leaders in the kingdom and have dominion and authority and conquer the enemy that's at our doorstep. With that, gentlemen, be blessed.